agendas of ideology, all these different things that are going on, and these killings just because of that pure hatred that people have. You know, gone are the days when people could disagree with one another, even sometimes very strongly, but still respect one another as human beings. You know, it used to be in politics, you know, 100, 150 years ago, that men could debate one another fiercely, you know, get very animated and attack each other's positions. But that was the thing, they attacked their positions, they attacked their beliefs, they didn't attack them specifically. And at the end of their debates, they could come together and shake hands and still respect one another as human beings while still disagreeing. Nowadays, it seems like if you disagree with someone politically or ideologically, and you don't see eye to eye with them, then they'll label you as evil. They'll label you as all these different things because you disagree. And that's the society that we are living in today. And then there's the debate about immigration. There's the migrant caravan that is supposedly on its way, you know, up through Mexico, and they're going to try to enter the United States. The president has sent troops to secure the border. And, you know, what is going to happen when those two groups come together? Will there be conflict? Can we, as a people, debate this subject, you know, whether you agree with them coming here, whether you disagree with them? Can we talk about that without being hateful to one another? There was a story I was reading in the newspaper today. It's almost election time. It comes up this Tuesday. I believe, again, it was in Tallahassee. There was a group of political people there. They were, you know, promoting their cause, and someone else came up to them and you know, basically said that they were Nazis and that they were, you know, killing people because of all, you know, their ideology. And just ridiculous stuff that's going on. And I say all that to get to this point is, what are we as Christians to do? What is the Christian to do amongst all of this hatred, amongst all of this conflict that is going on in our society today? Where do we stand? What do we do as Christians? Well, number one, as Christians, we're supposed to be beyond these conflicts as much as we can. The Bible tells us in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 12, Paul writes there, "For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places." As Christians, we're to understand that our battle is spiritual. That we are fighting against Satan. We are fighting against the things that he puts out there against us in a spiritual way. And maybe sometimes it spills over into the physical, but as Christians, we're supposed to try to be beyond all that. We're not to be fighting with one another over these things, but rather we're to be fighting a spiritual warfare against Satan. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 17, Paul says there, "Therefore go out from their midst," he's talking about those that are in the world, "go out from their midst and be separate from them," says the Lord, "and touch no unclean thing, then I will welcome you." We know that that can stand in between those who are battling one another and say, we need to stop this. We need peace in this situation. We need to be the ones that can be level-headed, the ones that can go in and help in this conflict. This peace here is one of the, or part of the fruit of the Spirit. In Ephesians, or in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, Paul says, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. We are called to be peacemakers. But more than just being called to be peacemakers, the Bible tells us that we are to pursue peace. Psalm 34, verse 14, there says, seek peace and pursue it. The word pursue there, we understand what that means. It means to chase after, to run after, to actively be seeking it. It's not enough for us to just sit back and say, well, we hope there's peace in this world. That's what we really want. You know, and I'm not going to be one who's involved in conflict, but I'm not going to get involved in other conflict. That's not what the Bible teaches us. We are to run after peace. We are to actively pursue that peace. One, we're to pursue it with our brothers and sisters in Christ, with fellow Christians. Get my slide there. Mark chapter 9, verse 50. Jesus there says, salt is good, but if the salt has lost its saltiness, how will you make it salty again? Have salt in yourselves, notice, and be at peace with one another. As Christians, first and foremost, we are to not have conflict with our brothers and sisters in Christ. Now again, as human beings, we know that conflict is going to come. There are going to be times when we are at odds with one another, but we must do everything in our power to resolve that conflict as quickly and as Christianly as possible. We need to be able to settle our differences so that we can be a light to those who are around. So that we can show the world around us that we are peaceful people. If we are constantly fighting with one another, if we are constantly hurting one another, if we're gossiping about one another, if we are not treating each other the way we need to be treating each other, how in the world can we be an influence to the world around us? How can we show them that Jesus, how can we show them His love and the fact that He wants that peace if we can't even have it ourselves? You know what? This is an important thing because it is mentioned over and over in Scripture. Let me share just a few more with you. Romans chapter 14 and verse 19. So then let us pursue what makes for peace. There's that word again. Pursuing peace and for mutual upbuilding. We're to be running after that peace. 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 11. Finally, brothers, rejoice. Aim for restoration. Comfort one another, agree with one another, live in peace. God, love, and peace will be with you. Notice these words right here in this passage. Aim for restoration, comfort one another, agree with one another, live in peace. We know that we're going to have differences of opinion. We know that we're not always going to see eye to eye with everything, but we have to be trying to live in peace. Much as we can. You know what? That basically means we need to learn to let things go. We don't need to be petty. We don't need to have our way all the time. In fact, the Bible teaches us that we're to put others before ourselves. And if we will do that, then we can find that peace that God wants us to have. A couple of more passages here. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 13. If you esteem them very highly in love because of their work, notice, be at among yourselves. And then finally, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 22. Flee the evil desires of youth and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Folks, this is just five passages from the New Testament. There are more that talk about us living in peace with one another. It is important to God that His children be peaceful. And not only are we to pursue peace with one another, the Bible teaches we're to pursue peace with everybody. Romans in our power to live at peace with everyone. Folks, that means we're not to be stirring up the pot. We're not to be troubling. I'll get to that in just a moment. I'm getting ahead of myself here. One more passage. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14. Strive for peace with everyone and for the holiness without which none will see the Lord. Notice that I like the phrase here on the screen. Work at living in peace with everyone. Because it is going to be work. It's not just going to come naturally. Because we are human beings, because we do have that conflict, because we have selfishness in our lives still, because we haven't learned to put our own desires away, it's going to take some work. Just like everything else in life takes work. It takes work to build a relationship. It takes work sometimes to love one another. We're going to have to work at living in peace. We can't just walk around like, you know, the hippies in the 60s with our peace symbol up and all that and expect peace to just happen. We're going to have to work at it. We've got to work at it the way the Bible teaches. So what does all this mean? What does it mean to live in peace with one another, to seek peace with everyone, to work at it? I think one of the main things here is that it means that we are peacemakers, not troublemakers. And yet so often you see Christians, people who are professing Christ, people who claim the name of Christ, right there in the middle of conflict, and oftentimes they are the ones that are promoting that conflict, whether it be in politics, whether it be in relationships, whatever it may be. We are not to be troublemakers. We are to be peaceful people promoting peace. That is with other Christians and with non-Christians as well. And so as Christians who are to be peacemakers, who are to be seeking after peace, that means that we need to be actively trying to diffuse situations in which there will be conflict. We need to be level-headed and cool as much as possible. And some of you are probably thinking, I'm not a level-headed or cool person, okay? I've got an attitude problem, or, you know, I'm hot-headed. Folks, we have to work on it. We have to strive to put that under control, to let God control that in our lives, and to not be troublemakers. To try to be the ones to diffuse situations, to be level-headed and cool. And to do that, we're going to have humility. We're going to have some patience with people. That's what God wants us to do. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 3. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. If we will put other people's needs in front of our own, then we can be humble. And we can go into the middle of conflict. We can go to where people are having that conflict and we can say, we need to solve this. We need to do this in a more calm manner. We don't need to be yelling and screaming and shouting at one another. We don't need to be brandishing weapons at one another. We need to be actively seeking peaceful solutions to things. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 12. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Folks, if we will strive for these attitudes in our lives, if we will strive for these characteristics, then we can be peacemakers. We can go to people and try to help them solve their conflict so that hopefully we can get beyond all of this going on in our world today. Not only are we to actively work and pursue peace, we are to pray for peace. And this is probably the most important thing that we can do in our lives as Christians, is to pray for peace. In your daily prayer life, whatever it is during the day that you are praying to God, and I hope that you are doing it, I hope that you have time set aside every day, whether it's the same time every day or whether it's whenever you have a moment, that you are praying. And then when you are praying for peace in our world today. You are praying for peace that God brings to people. that he will not be a president that will lead us into conflict, whether it be national conflict or personal conflict. We need to be praying for all of our elected leaders, members of Congress, our local leaders, our governor. We've got, again, an election coming up this Tuesday. I don't know who you're going to vote for. I don't really care. It doesn't matter. Whoever gets in office, number one, we need to remember that God has put him there, whether we think he should be there or not. And number two, that we need to be praying for. That we pray that they make those right decisions, that they lead us in the way that God wants them to, and that we can live peaceful and quiet lives. We need to be doing that. And I pray and I hope that we are doing that. And then again, we are to work for peace. We're to try and bring peace where there is conflict. And again, it's going to take work on our part. It's going to take us being actively pursuing that peace and trying to bring peace to people who are around us. If we will do that, James chapter 3 verse 18 says, peacemakers who sow in peace reap a harvest of righteousness. Now, I'm not naive enough to be sitting up here thinking that if we will do these things, that peace will come to the entire world, that war will cease to exist, and that there will never be any conflict ever again. I know that's not going to happen. But we can do more than we're doing. We can help bring peace to the conflict that's around us. We can help settle some of this hate if we will just be the kind of people that God wants us to be. If we will show people not only how we are living, but we will show them Jesus and show them how he is the only path to true peace. And some of that conflict, some of that hatred will go away. It's not all going to go away. There's been hatred since almost the beginning of the world. Cain killed his brother Abel because he was upset with him, because there was conflict, because he was mad, he was jealous. He has the hatred toward his brother. And ever since then, there has been that kind of conflict. It's not going to completely cease until Jesus returns and this world ends and we enter into. But we need to do everything that we can while we are here to promote that peace and to pray for it. There is a lot of conflict in this world, but as Christians, we are here to help bring peace where we can. We are here to help cease conflict where possible. But if you are a sinner, if you don't have Christ in your life right now, then you are in conflict with God. When Jesus came to this earth, he shed his blood on the cross. He gave his life for you so that you can cease that conflict with God, so that you can have peace with him. That's the reason he